In this video, I will give you an introduction to this week's challenge, digitization, data and geodata, and will shortly address how this challenge is related to the different themes and videos of this week. Digitization and the rising importance of so-called big data is an increasingly challenging topic, as it provides both huge opportunities for our everyday life, but also certain risks. So what does big data and information and communication technologies include? Today, an increasing amount of products is part of the so-called Internet of Things. Products that include sensors to measure movement, position, or physical characteristics, such as temperature, heart rhythm, etc. And these data can be used for all kinds of feedback for systems and appliances, and thus support decisions by users or professionals. In fact, this further swelling Internet of Things already resulted in so many connected devices and products that it has been necessary to change internet protocols recently from IPv4 to IPv6, which comes down to the creating of more internet addresses, as there were not enough anymore in the world. So what does this mean? How big is big data? How many addresses includes such an IPv6 standard? Just to give you an impression, it concerns an astonishing amount of addresses, which you could narrow down to 423,000 sensors that could theoretically be embedded in each DNA pair in every living human on Earth. And each of these addresses, or potential sensors, devices, they all result in generated data, which makes that we already have more data collected than there are grains of sand in our entire globe. When we look at this phenomenon of big data, it is important to remember that data alone has no value. We can collect it and store, but we need to add value to it. And this again needs immense computing power, like shown here with IBM's BlueJeans supercomputer. But be aware, only when data is elaborated by specialists, it becomes information. And only then it has real value for decision makers, citizens and users. But it has also value for others, who with all kinds of applications can help you as a citizen, user or decision maker to provide you with support or feedback to improve your everyday comfort or provide you with all kinds of opportunities. But the tricky thing is that at the same time, they get an astonishing detailed view into your everyday life, with all risks connected to that. This is often based to discussions regarding transparency and privacy. And of course, it includes a true dilemma, as we, as users, often have little to choose. So we either trust these companies, or if not, we are opting ourselves out for all these arising opportunities to address everyday challenges. The opportunities of big data have led to the rise of the smart cities, cities that are based on new opportunities of data collection and information and communication-based technologies. But why should we call them smart cities? Doesn't this imply that we now live in dump cities? Now, of course it doesn't, but as some of the first publicists on the concept of smartness of city-state, it concerns cities that utilize ICT solutions to fix the dump designs of the last century and in order to prepare them for the challenges of the 21st century. The concept of smart cities actually was introduced by IBM's CEO Sam Palmisano in 2008 in his speech titled "A Smarter Planet." In the years following that, it was taken by many other ICT companies like Cisco, Siemens, Accenture, Toshiba and many more. And in all these elaborations, smart cities are based on the principle that data tied to geography becomes important information. And data thus gives the city greater options for faster and more efficient, even real-time decision making. These concepts then address the following important six fields in the urban domain: mobility, the environment, the economy, its governance, and last but not least, people and the way they live. It includes a rising amount of technology that often is used to support policy and business frameworks. It connects the digital domain with the physical life of citizens, users, people in general. With many arising possibilities for increased support, effectiveness of urban systems, and in the end, comfort and prosperity of its users. Within this context, this week's challenge of digitization and geodata will be addressed from the different themes defined in this MOOC. The first theme that will be reflected upon is that of the effects of digitization to the shape and structure of cities. As digitization and the inclusion of data can lead to different interpretations regarding. Like here shown, the Cisco's interpretation of a smart city, namely Songdo in South Korea. Or here, Siemens' interpretation, Masdar City in the United Arab Emirates. The second theme addresses the importance and use of digitization and data for mobility and technical infrastructures, like shown here for the famous Dubai The Strip area. But it also includes a critical view on how digitization might affect our daily lives and how privacy-related issues arise. This, as it often brings up the question, to who belongs the data? And who has control? And are we aware, or should we even? Here shown is the so-called control room in aspiring smart city Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. An IBM-based example where not only urban traffic is controlled according to data and on congestion of traffic, but also including weather forecasts and coming events or disruptive issues. The result, however, is that the power of such private companies like Cisco, Siemens, IBM, and many more is significantly increasing in the urban domain. And besides of issues of privacy for citizens or users of cities and infrastructures, this also brings up other questions. Like, for instance, do we want Cisco cities, Siemens cities, or IBM cities? Or should we aim for finding a common base to digitization and its use in governance and transparency for users and the urban domain? And this addresses also to another important consideration. Data, as we as citizens use it, is often crafted into information by these companies, or in fact by the algorithms made by their engineers. So this involves certain risks. We may become so reliant on this feedback, on these systems, that our capacity to reason could not function without it. So if we want to use it in such way that we avoid such dependence and decreased resilience of us as intelligent human beings, then the opportunities provided by the Internet of Things should be the basis of the solutions. They should be based on people to machine, machine to people, and even machine to machine. And then they should enable citizens and enterprises to economize time, to improve individual mobility, facilitate access to information and services, save energy, water, and other essentials, and to have them participate in urban decision making. And only then it will lead to metropolitan solutions that lead to innovations to help improve sustainability, empowerment of citizens, and in the end, their prosperity. So how can this be done? I will touch very shortly on two other important aspects that will be addressed this week. First of all, the importance of the connection of data to geography, also known as GIS, or Geographic Information Systems. This will be explained in a separate video, but to provide you already with some insight here, an example from Amsterdam where different layers of information, like in this case, demographics, green areas, outdoor temperatures during a heatwave, and age and quality of buildings are interrelated to geography and provide city municipality insight to know where they have to act and to find the places where citizens are with the highest risk and thus where to address the challenge of, in this case, extreme inner city temperatures. For whom and how? But such connection of data to geography also provides other opportunities. For instance, to connect quantitative and qualitative data. Like here, for instance, the Yahoo Lab where besides the well-known shortest and fastest route from A to B, in this case in London, based on qualitative feedback by users, they also provide the most beautiful route and the most quiet route for users of the navigation system. Or here, the example of San Francisco, where the crossing of different data sources, in this case of crimes, with that of location of public schools, provides insight for decision makers where to act first to reduce risks. And this brings us to the final notion that will be addressed in this week's challenge: how to include citizens or users of urban areas and services and have them participate in urban decision making with use of the challenging opportunities of information and communication technologies. It is closely related to how we can create so-called networked environments and support of individuals or groups of individuals towards so-called interactive and empowered communities. The first step towards the creation of a new kind of cities, which does so, is the creation of social, political, and economic infrastructures that support the growth of smart citizens. So instead of aiming for smart cities, the crux is to aim for intelligent behavior and smart citizens. Only this will lead to the kind of intelligent cities which include feedback loops of knowledge to users to harness digitization and information technology to illuminate truths of urban life that are not absolute or self-evident in sensor collected data. Data that generated and understood the continuous physical interaction of human beings in urban space and reveals the unseen relations between urban communities and the wider natural system that support them. This might provide what we should aim for: citizen-focused, community-defined, and open-source cities. Cities that harness technology to enhance democracy and distributed governance, support individual and collective autonomy, and community participation in urban planning. And by doing so, they enshrine the citizens' right to privacy and protection from data commodification. Wrapping it all up, it is this series of themes that will be addressed in the coming videos regarding this week's challenge of digitization and geodata: shape and structure of urban settlements, the urban services and infrastructures and transportation, natural resources, livability and urban living, and policy and governance, all related to the digitized and interconnected society.